So my talk today is about functional programming and performance and going beyond the concepts of big O notation. And just real quickly, for those of you who weren't in my talk yesterday about lambdas, who am I? As Rafael said, I am the director of consulting for TypeSafe. TypeSafe isn't a consulting firm per se. You know, we do go out and help customers with specific problems they're having, but mostly we do best practices, code reviews, architectural reviews, that sort of thing. And for real consulting work, whenever you want somebody to come in and build a project with you, we have partners like Rafal with Virtus Lab, the software mill in Warsaw. Those are the kind of companies that will do the majority of the coding for you. I'm the author of Effective ACCA. I've been doing Scala for about 5 years. So I've been doing this in production for a pretty long time. So how many people here know big O notation? Yeah, just about everybody in the room. That's great. And it's a fantastic rule of thumb to have in your back pocket for understanding the impacts of using a particular data structure or algorithm, right? It's very good to know that something is going to be a constant time operation or a linear in cost operation. And in Scala, we have this web page which will tell you the performance characteristics of the various different collections that you might use. And it's very handy, but you know, that's not really showing you the entire picture, especially at runtime. So, you know, it's just good to have this, but then you actually do have to sit down and profile your application. We all know that this is a best practice, right? But many developers don't look much further. It's kind of a truism, right? We have to get something done. It's got to be rolled out into production this week. You know, who has time to sit down and really see how well this application is running? So at TypeSafe, we helped put together this concept of reactive applications. And it's not like this was a new concept. People have been using this term for a while. But there really wasn't a very good definition of what reactive meant. And so when somebody would say, well, I have a reactive application, nobody knew what exactly that was telling them. So what we did is we sat down and said, well, what does this mean? And we came up with four basic elements. The primary one is responsiveness. We want to be responsive to our users. And in that responsiveness, we're talking about how quickly we're able to handle requests that are coming in. But we're also talking about the fact that if servers go down, we can't respond, right? That's fault tolerance. Scalability. Whenever we're reaching max load, we need to be able to scale up and out. And by that, I mean up, use more of the cores on a particular box. Out, we want to use more, you know, nodes in our cluster. So there's various elements of this that make up reactive programming. And if you haven't seen reactivemanifesto.org, I highly recommend you go and read it and check out what it means. It's not meant specifically for Scala or ACCA or Play. It's meant for any language as something to aspire to develop applications in the 21st century. So highly recommend that you check it out. Now, how many people have seen this paradox here of your choice of what you can do when trying to be responsive to your users? A lot of people have heard of the CAP theorem, right? There's the consistency versus availability in the face of partitions. And, you know, that's a well-known theorem that people have been talking about for a while. You get to choose whether you can be consistent or available in the face of partitions. But when it comes to performance, we have this trade-off that's sort of shown here on this slide. We have to choose between latency, you know, how long it's going to take to handle particular requests, throughput, which is the speed at which we're going to be able to handle these requests. So latency is more of a time thing, but throughput is how many we can get through. And footprint. And footprint is, you know, how much memory we're going to use in order to do this. If I want to have a very fast application that is low latency, I want to probably give up footprint. Now, for a lot of people here, that probably isn't something we think about a tremendous amount unless we're working on a mobile platform. In the mobile world, this is something they have to think about a great deal. Footprint is obviously limited. But for our applications running on the JVM, we probably have a multi-gigabyte heap, and we're not quite as concerned about it. But you have to make choices between these. And it's not necessarily as strict as the cap theorem, but it's a general rule of thumb that you only get two out of these three. But there is also another element, power consumption. How many people think about power consumption? One, two. It's a big deal. Now, again, this is something that mobile developers think about a lot more because they don't want to be draining your battery as you're, you know, playing your game on their phone or you know, using their application. That would be bad. But in a data center, power consumption is also a really big deal. If we're wasting resources, we're hurting the environment, right? If we're just using tons of boxes to handle something that doesn't need that much scale, we're kind of wasting money. So it's not just the environment, but there's the cost aspect of it for your organization as well. I worked at a very large company in the United States for a couple months, and they asked me, all right, well, we're going to deploy a REOC cluster. How many boxes do you need for that? And I'm sitting there looking at this checklist of the amazing boxes I can get just to run my REOC cluster. And these machines are going to have a minimum 96 gigabytes of RAM, and you know they're going to be 24 cores, and that's awesome. I you know, just like Garrett was saying yesterday, I had that lust for the cool toys to play with, but did I need it? Did I need five boxes with that kind of stuff just to run REAC? That's probably a little bit of an overkill. Now, when it comes to this sort of thing, we don't really have standards, right? We don't have necessarily rules of thumb that we can use to make decisions up front. But what you do have to follow are your personal non-functional requirements for your project. How many of you have non-functional requirements for your projects? Okay. And then, you know, by this we say that we have to be able to handle a request within 10 milliseconds or something like that. That could be a non-functional requirement. And these are a really big deal. If you're not doing this, you probably should be sitting down and thinking about it because the cost of not doing it is even greater to your organization. So we in this room obviously love functional programming. We wouldn't be here if we didn't. And the real question is, what is functional programming? I said this yesterday whenever I was giving my Lambdas talk. I have three elements that I consider important to functional programming. Immutability, I don't want things changing on me so I can't reason about it at a given point in time. Referential transparency, which is the idea that if I'm going to operate on data, I'm not going to change the data that I'm operating on to get a new result. And a really good example of this is in Java. Has anybody ever used a string buffer? Yeah, a fair number. If you were to take a string buffer in Java and you were to reverse the string that you put into it to get a new value back, what does that do to the original string? It changes that as well. Who wants that? It's kind of a bad thing, right? And JavaScript has this all over the place as well, and that kind of drives me crazy when they say it's a functional language. But it does have this other element of first-class functions, right? And that's probably the one element that everybody thinks about whenever you're talking about functional programming. Category theory is another really great way of reasoning about your problems in a mathematical sense. But I don't think that that's necessarily functional programming per se. It's just an implementation detail of a way of doing functional programming. What we're really after here is abstractions, right? We love abstractions. And they help us reason about our logic. And they allow us to decouple our, you know, services. And we get a lot greater simplicity, possibly. A higher level of correctness in our application. And reuse. These are all wonderful things. And they make us feel like a stormtrooper riding a, you know, a flying dog. I just thought that picture was funny. So I throw these into my presentation to keep people awake. So, but it's, you know, a double-edged sword. We live in a world of abstractions already. Everything about what we're doing as a programmer is at an abstract level because we're not talking to the machine in machine language, right? The languages that we run on the JVM are DSLs. Yes? Do you have a question? Oh, okay, sorry. they are DSLs for running, you know, for generating bytecode. Scala is really just a library on the JVM. That's all it really is. And we call it a language, but the same thing goes for Clojure or JRuby or Groovy. These are all really just DSLs for the bytecode that will be emitted. Bytecodes are an abstraction over macro instructions for the machine, you know, the assembly level type instructions that you'll see. And then whenever you get further down into the pipeline to the core, you're starting to look at micro instructions. And those micro instructions are, you know, abstracted over by the macro instructions. So we have all of these abstractions already existing for us. And now we're writing code where we're defining even more abstractions. And we're getting further and further away from the way the machine actually thinks, right? So the JVM is built to run imperative code. It's how it's designed, because Java is an imperative language. And that means that it can execute imperative logic really fast. We see this. The fastest kind of looping or iteration we can do is through a while loop, right? That is going to be your fastest construct on the JVM. And the more that we move away from imperative logic, the higher the cost is in abstraction. And what are the penalties that we're going to pay in that regard? We're going to have increased allocations. And those increased allocations can have an impact on your garbage collection. More bytecode gets generated to perform tasks. For example, in Scala, we have our for comprehensions. Does everybody know what a for comprehension is in Scala? No, no, some people do. The idea is that if you were going to flat map over a collection or map over a collection or perform multiple different tasks over collections, sometimes it can be really difficult to reason about the logic that you're performing if you were to call flat map and map and filter and, you know, what have you. So a for comprehension gives us the ability to write using syntactic sugar flat map and map in a very simple way. You just say for, and you say, get me this element out of whatever container I have the values in. You know, do something with it and yield something. And, you know, that's an abstraction over an abstraction over an abstraction, et cetera, et cetera, right? And it will have increased allocations, especially if you're using things like persistent data structures, right? Everybody who's doing functional programming probably has an idea of persistent data structures and structural sharing. Does anybody not know what persistent data structures are? Persistent data structures. Anyway, the idea is that you're going to get a new data structure instance whenever you change anything in an immutable data structure. And it's going to use structural sharing, so you're not going to be paying the full cost of a copy. You are going to get a completely new set of references to the same data that was shared from the original data structure. But we have more bytecode that we're going to execute because we're using these abstractions. And we have less control over runtime performance. And these can be really painful problems to have whenever you're trying to profile, because you write code that you think is wonderfully elegant. And then you look at it, and it's running in production, and it's not doing so well. It's not meeting your requirements or your contract with your users. So there's a fine line here. And, you know, it's funny that Garrett's talked about how we as developers really, really like to do things a certain way. And we get attracted to new ways of doing things, and we want to write stuff this way. When I first learned pattern matching, I did everything in pattern matching instead of writing an if-else. And that actually drove, you know, some of the people I was working with crazy, because they were saying, well, this is just a two-case thing. You may as well just write an if-else. And I was like, yeah, all right, fine. But boy, I love the pattern match. You know, some people out there are going to really love the way Lisp looks and feels when they're coding it. And, you know, they love S expressions and they love prefix notation. Other people do not see beauty in that. We all have a personal aesthetic. And you can't let your own personal aesthetic guide the way you're going to program when you're thinking about performance. Because you're going to code in a way that may not necessarily be the fastest or most responsive way to, you know, solve that problem. So I have an example here of a company that I'm going to call out who is using Ruby on Rails. And that's not really necessarily relevant to us as functional programmers. But it's a really, really good story to understand the the pain that you're going to feel whenever you make bad decisions. And I'm not a big fan of Ruby on Rails. I do like using Ruby whenever I'm going to do scripting that's a little more complex than what I would do in Bash. But Ruby on Rails, to me, is just a waste of time. It's a great way to go to a hackathon and build an application or maybe hack something up real quickly to show a VC. But, you know, you're talking about a framework which is going to limit you to one connection that you can handle at a time. You know, you can use some tools like Unicorn to try and, you know, ramp that up to maybe four concurrent connections. But, you know, that's not a lot. Certainly not to anybody who's running on the JVM, right? So Rap Genius, they loudly complained in last year at some point, I forget when, about how Heroku changed their routing. They used to do routing based upon a round robin type of strategy. And that meant that, you know, every server was going to get requests. And they changed the way they did their routing to random, which meant that if Rap Genius was to add more dynos on Heroku, they were going to not necessarily use them because it was random distribution. You weren't guaranteed that your new dynos were going to receive any of these requests. And so they complained to, you know, Heroku and said, this is baloney, you know. We're a big customer of yours, and we really want to be able to stay on Heroku, but it's costing us too much. But their real problem is the fact that they're using 250 of these dynos, 250 virtual machines, at a cost of about $30,000 per month as a startup. Now, like I said, you could use a tool like Unicorn to be able to handle more of these kind of concurrent requests, but you might get three to four more. At 250 dynos, they're able to handle a max number of connections at any given time of 1,000 at a cost of $30,000 a month. And yeah, Garrett's are shaking his head. Yeah, and this is because they've made choices that have hurt them as far as their responsiveness to users and cost. So their problem is not, to me, the fact that Heroku switched to random. Their problem is that they're not using the right platform. Twitter went through this, right? Twitter was originally a Ruby on Rails shop, and eventually they realized that it just wasn't scaling for them, so they switched to the JVM. They were one of the first big name users of Scala. And, you know, they are moving everything to the JVM. They're still in the process of doing this, and it's been roughly 3 to 4 years. They still have some Ruby on Rails, especially more front-end stuff. So, what's the cost of the environment when you do this? You know, in 250 dynos, it's great for Heroku that people need to be able to do this, but it's not great for the environment that we're sitting there and running all of these machines to handle 1,000 concurrent requests. And there's also the cost factor. $30,000 a month when you're a startup is a tremendous burn rate for such low performance. So, you know, think about these things when you're making your choices. I'm sure that if Rap Genius had to do it over again, they would have reconsidered whether or not they would use Ruby on Rails. So, languages impose constraints on us, though, right? If we're a closure developer, typically we're going to use what, you know, tools are available to us inside the language closure. Same thing goes for Scala. Same thing goes for any language that you choose. And Rich Hickey had a really famous presentation last year where he talked about how, you know, we want to code like Bartok, and we want to, you know, have performance like who was the famous saxophonist? Nutson. I've forgotten his name. Coltrane. And what he talked about was that we want to have the ability to play our instrument in the best way possible, you know? And he mentioned that there are languages out there that are chusophones, to sort of use an instrumental kind of term. And I'm kind of in the opposite camp from Rich on this. I understand his point of view that, you know, a language should be able to do something particularly well, and it would be great if we could all have developers or be developers who can do many different languages to solve different problems across our application. But it's not reality. I mean, we may be able to do two or three languages pretty well, but very few developers can do 4 or 5 or 6 to be able to do some part of their application in Lua, another part of their application with Ruby, another part of their application with Python, you know, and then, you know, some stuff on the JVM with Clojure or Scala. And so it's a little more realistic to expect that developers are going to know one language pretty darn well and others to some degree. So I personally don't want to be constrained by a language and what features are made available to me. Now, if I'm a Clojure developer, I do have the ability to access Java libraries. And that's wonderful. As an example of this, how many people have heard of the Storm framework? Now, really good for stream processing in a distributed environment. Around version 0.7, Nathan Mars pulled in the Disruptor framework. How many people have heard of Disruptor? It's a high-performance queuing mechanism. And it is extremely good for throughput and low latency. It breaks all the rules of functional programming. It pre-allocates stuff so that it doesn't pay allocation costs. And it's using mutable state. But it's extremely fast. And when Nathan started using the Disruptor framework in order to do queuing inside of Storm, he increased the performance of Storm by 3 times. That's significant. You know, it's not orders of magnitude, but that's still a really large increase. And it just goes to show that there are times when it's important to be able to leverage tools outside of what we have inside of our own language. Jose Valin made a really good point about this yesterday, talking about how languages define what we see. And sometimes we have to reach outside of there. Scala is not a language like that. Scala is a much more flexible language, and that can have its good and bad sides. You know, if you're going to use a language like Scala, you have to know, as an organization, how you're going to use Scala. You have to agree and have a contract among all the developers in your organization that this is the best practices and the standards for how we're going to write our language or write our applications. And there are a couple of different resources out there if you need something to get started, like Twitter has their own effective Scala. The scalalang.org site has its own coding, you know, guidelines. And those are really useful. Languages will pick abstractions for us, and then we can be kind of boxed in. As an example, Scala developers are mostly known for using actors in the Akka toolkit, right? Clojure developers have core.async. Go has its channels, which are, you know, CSP-based, communicating sequential processes based on the paper by Tony Hoare back in, I think, the late 70s. And these aren't necessarily a one or the other choice. If you're using communicating sequential processes, they're almost a dual to actors. Actors do not have green threads built into them. The idea that I can have one thread and I'm going to leverage that in multiple different ways by different parts of my application, right? That's what communicating sequential processes can do. Actors, however, do have the benefit of giving you asynchrony and having fault tolerance built into it, and having, you know, location transparency so that the location of the actor is completely irrelevant inside of my code. I never have to worry about whether that actor is located on the same node or on a completely different data center. It's irrelevant to me as a coder. So there are trade-offs in both, and there may be times where I want to say, as a developer, I want to use actors to receive messages that are coming in from some external system. But then once I've received the messages, I do want to use these green threads, right, and be able to leverage as much out of a thread as I possibly can. This is a really powerful concept, but a lot of people aren't thinking in that terms. It's always one or the other, and I think that's to our detriment. We also kind of need to be treated like adults. It's really nice whenever somebody says that, I think this is how we should solve our problems. But you know what? They don't have my problems. I've got my problems, and they bother me. I've got to solve my problems the way that works best for my particular application. And how someone like Rich Hickey feels about that is usually irrelevant to me. So it's nice that Rich has a very strict interpretation of how applications should be built, and that he gives us guidelines for how we should do this. But it's sort of like bowling when you have the guardrails up in the gutter there. Sometimes, you know, it's not such a bad thing to be able to shoot your foot off trying to do something even better. And by that, I'm not saying that you're going to completely fail. I'm just saying that you're going to make mistakes, but you're going to be able to write something that's more performant and less of a hack because you didn't have the tools inside of the language. So, when we use an external library, how many people here have used an external library that they got from some Maven repository or some gem or something like that? And did you ever look to see if they have performance tests? Does anybody know of any library out there with performance tests? Okay, that's a good example. Guava will. Google's very concerned about this sort of thing. Why? Because they have data centers, and they are concerned about the cost of deploying an application that is inefficient, which is funny, actually, because if you use Guava's MapMaker or something like that, I was watching a presentation by, does anybody know who Attila Szegedi is? He is a Hungarian who works for Oracle now. He was the performance specialist at Twitter, and he was talking about how MapMaker, if you use a MapMaker inside of Guava, it comes up with an initial allocation on the order of 2 kilobytes just for creating one. That's kind of expensive. But anyway, not having these performance tests mean that you don't necessarily know the implications of pulling in one of these libraries, and you don't know how that's going to affect your application. Not necessarily a great thing. I wish that more libraries out there did performance testing, but I don't see it happening as much as I rail against it. And nobody found this picture funny, by the way. Right, if you go jumping on that trampoline, you're going to get hurt. So, all right, maybe it's too early in the morning. So, asynchrony. Asynchrony is a wonderful thing, and being able to leverage the ability to scale, scale up on a machine, use more and more of your cores. It's really wonderful, but that doesn't necessarily mean it's the fastest way to go. I pointed out the disruptor framework before. I highly recommend anybody who's looking for performance improvements, look at the disruptor. It's a great library, and it's bulletproof because it's been used in production at a very large exchange in the UK called LMAX for many years. And, it's doing work on a single thread much faster than anything asynchronous could do because it's not paying the cost of context switches off of a particular core. Those context switches can be very expensive. They can increase the latency of your application. So there are times where you may want to pin to a core, which incidentally is one of the costs of the disruptor, in the footprint. Using the disruptor means that one core of whatever box you're running on is now dedicated strictly to that queue. So, trade-offs, right? We have to pay attention to Amdahl's law. Daniel yesterday, whenever he was talking about scaling to 180,000 cores, was talking about, he showed a very similar graph to this, and he also showed another which showed performance degrading as you scaled out over more cores. It's a very, very powerful concept. Amdahl's law is very important in this world where we're going to be using more and more cores. There is a cost associated with this, and one of the biggest examples of this is in parallel collections. When we came up with parallel collections inside of Scala, we were super excited. But I don't know hardly anybody using them in production now. So Java's about to roll out their parallel collections with Java 8. Great. Let's see how that works out for you. Because for us, the cost of the join is so great that you're losing value over probably not parallelizing that task. This can be very specific to what you're doing, right? Here's an example. Akka actors use the fork join pool on the JVM to provide threads to actors. Now, the fork join pool is going to leverage all of the cores on your box. And if you used it for a parallel collection, which is the implementation you're going to see in Java 8 and in Scala, it's going to say, all right, I'm going to break your task apart, and hopefully we have data that is both commutative and associative so that we don't have to worry about the impact of adding one to each value inside of a list or something like that. Breaking it apart across all the cores and letting them process as much work as they can individually. That's great. But the join cost at the end is so great, joining the data back together, that it may have been more valuable to you to not use a parallel collection. So if you're going to use it, make sure that you benchmark the two. That's really important. And that's what Amdahl's law is really about. Amdahl's law is saying that the cost of what you can't parallelize can impact the value of parallelization. So at the hardware level, we have computers which are built in message passing from the ground up. How many people know the MESI protocol? It's really MESI plus F now. Anybody? This is at the lowest level of your processors and how they talk to one another. The cores need to maintain coherency across their low-level caches. They have information specific to a core. They have information that is specific to an entire socket. And then they need to be able to talk cross-socket to other sockets. You may have a server with as many as 10 to 15 sockets inside of it. They all have to maintain cache coherency, and they do that through this protocol called MESI plus F. Modified, exclusive, shared, and invalid. If I want to change a value, I've got to have it loaded inside of my local caches and bring it down to a register. And I need to say if I want to change it that, hey, everybody else who has this, I'm going to have exclusive rights to it. And if I do change it, now it becomes modified. Anybody who also has a copy of it in the cache line inside of their caches, they now have an invalid value, right? It's a really important state machine to your processors. And so from the ground up, we're talking about message passing. And if we're writing code that isn't thinking at the same level as the processors, we are now sort of pulling ourselves away from the metal, as it were. Even on the JVM, in a virtualized platform, you can write code that is very low level. People like Martin Thompson, Gil Tenet. Martin Thompson, by the way, was one of the original creators of the Disruptor Framework, and he's an excellent person to find presentations about online. He has a whole meme called Mechanical Sympathy with a mailing list and a blog that will help you find the tools you need to understand performance at a low level on the JVM. Gil Tenet works for Azul Systems as their CTO. They write the Zing JVM. These are people that, if you really care about performance, you need to start listening to, just to hear what they're saying. Even if you don't understand it at first, believe me, as you listen to them more, it's going to make sense, and you will hear these nuggets of just absolute gold that will help you tune your application. So what are some things we want to avoid? Like I said, parallel collections, because the join is typically more expensive than if we weren't going to go and spread that work across cores. Software transactional memory. How many people are using this? So, you know, it's big enclosure. It's terrible. It completely falls over at scale. We have Scala at STM as a library. And, you know, it's great if what you want to do is make a transaction out of having a user change their first and last name, and that was two separate fields. So, you know, I have a method that's going to take a first and last name, and I want to update those in a single transaction so that nobody ever sees, you know, an intermediate, you know, first name change but the last name not. You can use software transactional memory for this because it doesn't change a lot. Who changes their name frequently? Hopefully nobody. You know, we wouldn't know what to call them. But if you're going to work at scale with a data set of 20 million elements inside of a collection and you want to use STM in something that's going to change a lot, the collisions are going to kill you. It's not going to work. It's the laws of physics. So if you're running at any particular scale and using STM, it will fall over on you. On the JVM, if we do a return out of a closure, and, you know, like we have a Lambda or something like that, and we do a return, an explicit return out of a Lambda, that would be really, really bad because the JVM has to do that through, believe it or not, throwing an exception. Yeah, that's not what we want. Boxing, this is a known cost on the JVM. You don't have control over it in Scala because we don't make a differentiation between the primitive types and the, you know, the complex objects. We have an int, and you don't know whether that's a primitive int or being treated as a, you know, an integer object. And you do know that if you go and put ints into a collection, and before they weren't in a collection, those values now have to be boxed. By the rules of the JVM, they have to be boxed. They have to be made into integer objects to go into a collection. And anytime you return a value out of a method, that also gets boxed. Even though you think you're returning a primitive, it has to be boxed to be returned from a method on the JVM. And there's nothing we can do about that. I put lambdas here, but that was really just me trolling. Yeah. Anybody who saw my presentation yesterday knows what I think about that. So, as a quick digression, don't use OSX for profiling. Yeah, yeah. You know, I have a Mac because I need to be able to go to a client site and not worry about whether or not I can connect to their VPN. I've struggled with that for, you know, too long in my life. I love Linux, but, you know, whenever you really want to be profiling on a machine that is your target. You don't want to be, you know, getting these numbers off of machines that are not the same as what you're going to be running in production. It just makes sense. You can do some low-level profiling on a box like OSX, but the tools are more limited. And worse yet, the JVM that you get from Apple, if you're not using OpenJDK, is got some funky visibility issues. And by that, I mean if I have multiple threads running and I need for a value to be seen on another thread, on another core, you know, I can put memory barriers in place like volatile to try and make sure that gets communicated to the other thread. But it doesn't always work on OSX. It's maddening. So, FYI. Tools have issues. The tools that we typically use for Java development, you know, how many people use JStack? How many people use, you know, heap dumps and stuff like that? When we do these, when we use these tools, they have to wait for the JVM to come to a save point, a place in time where all the threads are not doing anything so they can collect this information. We're getting a snapshot, but we're not really seeing what the application is doing in a live state. So it's sort of flawed in that regard, right? Here are some tools that I personally trust. JHiccup. Has anybody ever heard of this one? Okay, great. This is, again, Gil Tenay, the CTO of Azul. It's an open source project. You can download it and go nuts. It's going to help you figure out when you've got pauses and stalls at your threads running on a core. Stalls are killers if you're trying to get maximum throughput. If you have an algorithm that's going to be trying to, you know, run through some data real quickly, a stall would be a case where it couldn't get the data from main memory or from some cache quickly enough, and it had to wait. That's bad. Java Micro Benchmarking Harness. This is something that Alexei Shipilev from Oracle is currently working on. And it's a really fantastic tool for helping you figure out how well a particular method is going to run inside of your application. And it's easy to use, but it really only works well from Java. So I've gotten this to work with Scala, and I really wanted to show a new SBT plugin that would allow you to use it directly from Scala. But unfortunately, Scala's compiler doesn't work the same way that Java's compiler does with these things called annotation processors, and therefore I couldn't. But Alexei is working on it for me right now. Hopefully I'll have an SBT plugin for this, you know, in the next month or two. So, and this is a really useful tool for helping you figure out how well your application is running. Some people use Caliper. How many people have heard of that library? There's been a really great debate on the mechanical sympathy mailing list about, you know, why Caliper and Java Micro Benchmarking Harness are different. Just trust me, go with JMH for now. If you want to find out more, I recommend you check out the discussion on the mechanical sympathy Google group. I'm running low on time, so I can't go through this really quick. Anyway, printgc stats. When you are running, you want to make sure that you use a flag to have all of your GC information go to, or really all the output of your JVM go to a file. If you don't have it going to a file, it's just going to the console, which is limited in your ability to see and retrieve old information, of course, right? After something goes wrong, you can use printgc stats as a tool, as a post-mortem, to help you figure out what's went, you know, from a garbage collection perspective, what happened inside the application. Very useful. For visualizing GC at runtime, there's a fairly new application from a company, I forget the name of the, oh, jClarity is the company. Sensum is the tool. Really good for visualizing GC. You need to know how your application is running from a garbage collection perspective if you want any hope of performance. Another one is GarbageCat. If you absolutely have to just, you know, load something up and use it quickly, VisualVM comes with pretty much every download of the JVM. And you can just get the Visual GC plugin and see what's happening with Concurrent Mark Suite. HTOP is a really nice tool for helping you visualize what's happening in your application from the user space versus the kernel, right? If you're trying to get maximum performance, you may want to pin two cores because you do not want the interference of the kernel affecting your application. So you pin to cores that you are fairly confident Linux is not going to be using for interrupts and stuff like that. And HTOP will help you visualize the impact of kernel usage versus user space usage inside of your application. DStat, this is a really great tool. It replaces several other tools that we were all using before, like VMStat, IOStat. It gives you CPU usage visualization, memory usage, asynchronous IO. That's a really great thing to watch. But also, you see that top bio there at the end? Top bio is telling you blocking input and output operations. That's a really good thing to see, especially if you're going to be working with, you know, say, JDBC or something like that, which is a library for connecting to databases on the JVM. A lot of those, you know, I think JDBC by definition, is a blocking, you know, driver. And if you're going to use it, see the impact on your application. OProfile, really good system-wide Linux profiler. Has anybody ever heard of OProfile? Yeah, really, really nice. So for, if you're going to do this pinning to cores that I was mentioning before, NUMA control is your friend. NUMA is the idea of non-uniform memory access and the impact of the location of a core on a particular socket accessing main memory versus another core, which may be physically closer and can get to it quicker, causing different dynamics in your application because, you know, this core over here is going to see stuff slower than this one over here. NUMA control is just a way for you to pin to specific cores. If you know enough about your physical hardware, you can use NUMA control to pin to cores. And there's task set as well. Task set doesn't give you the same fidelity that NUMA control does, but it is useful if you're just running on a single socket box, like a laptop, and you're just trying to do something real quickly. If you're going to do any kind of performance benchmarking, pin to a core for that process, please. You'll see more throughput in doing so. Not affected by kernel stuff. JVM flags I find particularly useful. You know, print GC details, print GC date stamp, print GC cause. What caused this garbage collection to take place? And these things will add up to really large files, so you have to have, you know, the ability to write this out to a file and enroll it and stuff like that. Print tenuring distribution, print GC application stop time, print save point statistics. Those points in time in the JVM where it's figuring out, okay, now's the time when I can do a GC if need be. You know, it's all the threads coming to a point and saying, all right, are we good or not? Print flags final. If you want to know the configuration of your JVM at runtime, do a print flags final. It's a really long listing, but it will show you every single configuration item inside of the JVM. And then there's print assembly if you're feeling particularly frisky. If you really want to see the assembly that's, you know, the macro instructions coming out of the JVM at runtime on that particular platform, print assembly allows you to do that. But you have to unlock the diagnostic VM options. Also, don't overuse memory barriers. Does everybody know what volatile is on the JVM? This is my what I was saying earlier about having, you know, one thread over here, which is changing a value, then another thread over here is also using, and you want it published so that the other thread can see it at that point in time. You want to guarantee that the other thread will see the change, right? And volatile gives us that capability without locks. Really powerful. But you don't have to make all the variables volatile inside of a class. What you do have to do is make one of the variables volatile and make sure it's the last one you change, and then you publish. By having that one volatile, it will publish all of the things in a happens before mechanism. Very important concept to a memory model, this concept of happens before. So it's 9:51. I was going to show some code, but I think I probably kind of run over here. But does anybody have any questions? Yes?
You just mentioned the volatile variables. Do they have to work in Scala? Because in Java, they don't.
No, they do. And in Java, they do. What don't you see working about volatile?
Well, for example, I believe I have seen some test that show that if you use volatile as a keyword in Java on virtually anything but, I don't know, GUI, there are situations in which it really doesn't work.
Well, if it's on OS X, I believe you. On Linux, I've never seen volatile not publish. The JVM is so battle-hardened and such an impressive piece of engineering whenever it comes to a multi-threaded application being deployed. Believe me, if volatile didn't work, the entire world would be screaming about it.
Well, my information on the subject might be outdated.
You know what? We can talk later. If you find something, please send it to me. I would love to read it. Anybody else? Yes?
I have a question. You mentioned that STM, transactional memory, is bad. Could you repeat the arguments?
I
did not quite get it.
Sure. STM is compare and swap at large, right? I've got multiple fields that I want to update, but I don't want them to all be updated atomically. I want to have one atomic transaction for all of the fields updating. Like I said, first and last name. I don't want to update first name, have somebody do a, get first name and last name before I've set the last name as well and get some value that's not quite right, right? A name that isn't quite right. And STM allows us to say, well, I have a block of code here that's going to be an atomic transaction for memory, not to a database, right? Software transactional memory works really well for a limited number of fields with a limited number of updates. So the first and last name example is a great way to do it because you know the impact is probably small. The likelihood of somebody changing first and last name a million times in a second is so infinitesimally small, right? You're not going to worry about collisions. But at scale, when you're talking about millions of elements inside of a data collection, right, and you're talking about lots of updates taking place inside of that collection, STM falls over. It can't commit because when it goes to do the compare at the time of committing, the value has changed because somebody else made a change to it, and it can't put the new value in unless it knows that it had the right value first, right? So it's physics. And now there's hardware transactional memory coming down at the actual physical core level. And I'm not convinced, and most people I know who I really respect aren't either, that it will work either. So it's nice that they're putting it in there, but at scale it will work. And mind you, I'm talking about there is no rule of thumb of when it starts to fall over. But when it does, it makes your application just blow up in terrible ways. It's like a live lock. You know what a live lock is, where the application is still running, but unable to get past itself? That's, pretty much what happens.
I think we have time for one more question, and then we will move to the second presentation, actually. We will make a 2 minutes break after the second presentation.
Well, thank you.